The Civil War was a devastating period in American history. Over 620,000 soldiers lost their lives between 1861 and 1865, making the Civil War the bloodiest conflict ever to be fought on United States soil. But soldiers weren't the only people deeply affected by the bloody conflict. The Civil War would affect civilians just as deeply throughout the course of the war and for many years afterward. What sort of hardships did civilians endure? How were their lives changed? At Antietam National Battlefield outside of Sharpsburg, Maryland, Park Ranger Manny Gentile gives students an insight of how the battle affected the lives of civilians in the surrounding area.
All of the farms around here suffer damage. Now let's think about this battle. The battle is hard. The fences are destroyed, both through artillery fire, infantry action, and the fact that soldiers simply need that as firewood. Fences are gone. What livestock there is left has either been consumed by the armies or is out. This means pigs are loose. Dead soldiers are everywhere. What do pigs eat?
Anything
they can. No.
It's important to remember that the battle is not just fought in an open field. It's fought in somebody's field, somebody's hometown, somebody's neighborhood.
In 1861, war came upon an unsuspecting family that seemed to get caught in the crossfire. The house is located in Manassas and became embedded in a man-made storm. Judith Henry is an 85-year-old widow living with her daughter and slave. The morning of the battle, her son had come from another farm in order to urge Judith and company to evacuate the homestead. In the heat of the moment, they decided the best way to move Judith was to pull her out on a mattress. Not a very fun way to travel, and especially with the war on her heels, but when the sounds of battle raged closer, they moved back inside. Soon, Confederate soldiers started to congregate around the house for the shelter that it provided. By this time, the Union big guns had rolled up close to the house, and what better opportunity for rebel soldiers to pick off the gunners while being covered by shelter? Well, to defend themselves against the harassment fire, the cannons turned and fired on the house. To the defense of the Union army, they were unaware of the innocents who were hiding inside. The cannons went off and ultimately killed Judith Henry. She became the first life lost in the crossfire of innocence.
Jenny Wade of Gettysburg, Pennsylvania would suffer a similar fate. At the Battle of Gettysburg on July 3, 1863, Miss Wade was kneading dough in the kitchen of her sister's home when a stray mini ball passed through two doors and struck her directly in the left shoulder. She would die instantly from her wound, which passed through her shoulder blade and struck her heart.
A civilian casualty of war happened at Harper's Ferry, West Virginia. Frederick Roeder was a prosperous baker, father of seven, and recent widower. Being a Union sympathizer, he longed to see the United States flag flying over the Maryland shore. Venturing out to the Potomac River, he gazed at the Stars and Stripes, only to be struck down by a ricocheting bullet fired by a Union soldier. He crawled back to his home where he died, becoming the first townsperson die during the war.
For those who did not witness the horrors of war raging almost literally at their back doors, the photography of Matthew Brady gave civilians a glimpse into the grotesque reality of death on the battlefield.
Brady assembled corps of photographers to go out and document the war firsthand from the battlefield itself. Though he did not personally take all the photographs, he managed and collected the work of each of his photographers and created an archive depicting the Civil War by means of undeniable and visual truth. As New York Times put it, Mr. Brady has done something to bring home to us the terrible reality and earnestness of war. If he has not brought bodies and laid them in our dooryards and along our streets, he has done something very like it. In the end, his project to photographically document the war left him completely unappreciated by those to whom the war had become an ugly reality that they would rather leave behind them. However, years later, Congress purchased an entire collection, and it is now preserved as an important representation of American history in the time of the Civil War. The war was brought home through letters from loved ones as well. Major Sullivan Ballou writes a letter to his wife, contemplating his effort in the war and his inevitable demise.
My very dear wife, indications are very strong that we shall move in a few days, perhaps tomorrow. Lest I should not be able to write you again, I feel inclined to write a few lines that may fall under your eye when I shall be no more. If it is necessary that I should fall on the battlefield for my country, I am ready. I have no misgivings about or lack of confidence in the cause in which I am engaged, and my courage does not halt or falter. I know how strongly American civilization now leans upon the triumph of government, and how great debt we owe to those who look for us through the blood and suffering of the revolution. And I'm willing, perfectly willing, to lay down all my joys in this life to help maintain this government and to pay the debt. I cannot describe to you my feelings on this calm summer night when 2,000 men are sleeping around me, many of them enjoying the last, perhaps that, of death. And I, suspicious that death is creeping behind me with this fatal dart, am communing to God, my country, and thee.
Sullivan died in the First Battle of Manassas as he predicted, and did not return to his wife or his children.
Women during the Civil War faced many incredible difficulties. The very nature of war calls men to the battlefield and away from home, which meant that they would have to leave behind their families and loved ones. And in the event of the Civil War, with brother fighting against brother, the only men left at home were but small boys not yet old enough to fight, and men who were no longer able to due to age or disability. In such a vulnerable state, women had to learn to fight for themselves, and in many cases they fell victim to the merciless and atrocious acts of war committed during raids, because they had no one left to defend them. Their homes and land were destroyed and burned, and in many cases they were beaten and even worse. Everything they knew and loved was taken from them as a military tactic to demoralize the opposing side.
You know, they were literally beaten, you know, to try to get, they would actually hang them by their neck, torturing them, not actually killing them, but even elderly people trying to get them to disclose where valuables were hidden. And it was just all kind of atrocities, women raped and then the homes burned and literally left even in the winter with snow on the ground, left with absolutely nothing and having to walk miles to get to the nearest town or house.
Yeah, wouldn't they go the in and they, Emma's they could kill all, they take all their livestock, all their...
Absolutely, yeah, kill their or, yeah, even just slaughter the animals and leave them there just for the sake of trying to leave the people with nothing.
However, as the war continued, women began to grow restless and tired of the abuse. They rose up and took matters into their own hands. On April 2nd of 1863 in Richmond, Virginia, due to economic damage resulting from the war, there was massive food shortages. Starving women of Richmond marched into the Capitol Square in an angry mob shouting, "Bread! Bread!" They began smashing windows and looting stores for food, and as their numbers increased, over 1,000 women and a few men filled stores and warehouses. Confederate President Jefferson Davis took money from his own pockets, throwing it into the crowd, shouting, "You say you are hungry and have no money. Here. Here is all I have." Then he proceeded to tell them that if they did not cease and go home, he would order the militia to fire on them. And with that, they all scattered. Women also played less direct roles in the war, such as spending their time sewing uniforms and flags in support of wherever their loyalties fell, whether it be in the Union or with the Confederates. Though some women were not so content to play their part with a sewing needle, in few cases, women pretended to be men and ran off to war to join the battlefront. Other less combatant women did their part as a spy. A Southern woman by the name of Belle Boyd, also known as the Cleopatra of the Secession, was a spy for the Confederacy during the Civil War, operating out of her father's hotel in Fort Royal, Virginia. She provided valuable information to General Stonewall Jackson. Another woman who was a spy, Elizabeth Van Loo, played an invaluable role to the Union. Living in Richmond, she visited Union prisoners held by the Confederates and brought them clothes and food and blankets. During her visits, she collected information from Union soldiers about the Confederate plans and relayed it to General Grant himself. She was made the Postmaster General as a reward for her service to the Union. The most prominent and obvious role that women played during the war was in the medical field. Nurses were obviously in high demand with a growing number of wounded men and the issue of disease that ran rampant in military hospitals. Many women were responsible for the fundraising and collecting of medical supplies that saved many lives during the war. And though many were lost, if it hadn't been for the support and effort of these women, many more would have died.